Matter is everywhere around us and makes up everything we can touch, see, and feel. The chair you sit on, the water you drink, the air you breathe, and even your own body. In more scientific terms, matter is any substance that has mass and occupies space. It is made up of atoms, which in turn are made up of smaller particles called protons, neutrons, and electrons. Protons and neutrons reside in the nucleus or the center of the atom, while electrons orbit around this nucleus. The mass of an object is primarily determined by the number of protons and neutrons in its atoms. Also, do not confuse mass with weight. Weight is influenced by gravity while mass is not. You will have the same mass on Earth as you will on Jupiter, but you will not have the same weight. This distinction is crucial in understanding not just how matter behaves, but also in exploring phenomena that are beyond traditional matter, like gravity. It is a force that causes interactions between objects with mass, yet it does not have mass itself. Other phenomena that is not considered to be matter include energy, sound waves, electromagnetic waves, quantum particles like photons, dark energy, and the very fabric of the universe, space-time, as described by Einstein's theory of relativity. But the most interesting aspect of it all is its origin, the Big Bang, or that's what the most widely accepted explanation for the origin of matter is. In 1929, Edwin Hubble made the incredible observation that wherever you look, galaxies are moving away from us. He also noticed that the further a galaxy is, the faster it seems to be moving away. In other words, the universe is expanding. The fact that galaxies are moving away from each other also suggests that, in the past, they must have been closer together. This leads us to the idea that there was a time, known as the Big Bang, when all matter in the universe was exactly at the same place and therefore infinitely small and infinitely dense. If there were events earlier than this time, they would have no influence on the current state of the universe as we know it. Their existence can be ignored because it would have no observational consequences. This is because the singularity at the Big Bang represents a boundary in time beyond which our current understanding and observational tools cannot reach. Essentially, if anything did exist before the Big Bang, it has no observable impact on the universe as we see it today. This makes the Big Bang a practical starting point for our understanding of the history of the universe. In the Friedman model, which is a part of the Big Bang theory, as the universe expands, any matter or radiation in it gets cooler. Specifically, when the universe doubles in size, its temperature falls by half. And since temperature is essentially a measure of the average energy or velocity of particles, the cooling of the universe would have a major effect on the matter within it. At extremely high temperatures, particles move with such rapidity that they can overcome the forces of nuclear or electromagnetic attraction, essentially preventing them from clumping together. However, as the universe began to cool, particles moving at slower speeds were increasingly influenced by these attractive forces. This led to particles that naturally attract each other beginning to aggregate, setting the stage for the formation of more complex structures. At the Big Bang itself, however, the universe is thought to have begun as a singularity, which we will discuss later. But at this point, the universe was incredibly tiny, essentially zero size, and extremely hot. And as the universe expanded, the temperature of the radiation decreased. 1 second after the Big Bang, it would have fallen to about 10,000 million degrees. This is about 1,000 times the temperature at the center of the Sun, but temperatures as high as this are reached in H-bomb explosions. At this time, the universe would have contained mostly photons, electrons, and neutrinos, which are very lightweight particles that are influenced mainly by two things, weak nuclear force and gravity. Along with these particles, their antimatter counterparts, as well as a smaller number of protons and neutrons, were also present. As the universe kept expanding and cooling, the creation of new matter and antimatter pairs slowed down, and most of them annihilated each other, turning into photons. This left behind a small number of electrons. Neutrinos and their antiparticles, however, didn't annihilate each other in the same way because they interact very weakly with other particles. Because of this weak interaction, these neutrinos from the early universe are still present today. About 100 seconds after the Big Bang, when the temperature had cooled to 1,000 million degrees, similar to the temperature inside the hottest stars, protons and neutrons would no longer have sufficient energy to escape the attraction of the strong nuclear force, which is one of the fundamental forces in physics that binds particles in an atomic nucleus, and the protons and neutrons would have then started to combine together to produce atoms of deuterium or heavy hydrogen, which contain one proton and one neutron. The deuterium would then have combined with more protons and neutrons to make helium nuclei, which contain two protons and two neutrons, and also small amounts of a couple of heavier elements like lithium and beryllium. It's estimated that during this period in the early universe, about 1/4 of all the protons and neutrons were transformed into helium. This process also produced a small amount of heavy hydrogen and other elements. Any remaining neutrons that didn't get converted into helium eventually broke down into protons. These protons are what make up the nucleus of ordinary hydrogen atoms, the most abundant element in the universe. Within only a few hours of the Big Bang, the universe would have cooled down enough to stop the formation of helium and other elements. After this, for about a million years or so, the universe would simply expand and cool without much happening. Eventually, once the universe cooled to a few thousand degrees, electrons and atomic nuclei didn't have enough energy to overcome the electromagnetic attraction between them, leading to the formation of atoms. While the universe continued to expand and cool, certain areas were a bit denser than others. In these denser areas, the pull of gravity slowed down the expansion a little. Over time, in some of these regions, the force of gravity became strong enough to stop the expansion and even start pulling everything back in. As this happened, these areas of matter could begin to spin. This is because as you move closer to the center, the rotational speed increases to conserve angular momentum. This same principle applies to the early universe. As regions of matter began collapsing due to gravity, their size shrank, just as skaters spinning on ice spin faster as they draw in their arms. This spinning led to the formation of disc-like structures called galaxies. If a region of matter started spinning as it collapsed, it would form a galaxy with a distinct disc shape. If, however, the region didn't pick up any spin, it would form a different type of galaxy called an elliptical galaxy. These are more oval-shaped and don't spin as a whole, but they are made of parts that orbit around their center. So this was how galaxies started to form in the universe, marking the beginning of the large-scale structures we see in the universe today. As time went on, the hydrogen and helium gas in the galaxies would break up into smaller clouds that would collapse under their own gravity. As these contracted and the atoms within them collided with one another, the temperature of the gas would increase until eventually it became hot enough to start nuclear fusion reactions. These would convert the hydrogen into more helium, and the heat given off would raise the pressure and stop the clouds from contracting any further. They would remain stable in this state for a long time to stars like our sun, burning hydrogen into helium and radiating the resulting energy as heat and light. They would then contract slightly, and as they heated up further, would start to convert helium into heavier elements like carbon or oxygen. We are not entirely sure what happens after, but in some stars, the core might collapse becoming a neutron star or a black hole. Meanwhile, the star's outer layers might be expelled out in a massive explosion called a supernova, which is so bright it can outshine all the other stars in its galaxy. This explosion scatters the heavier elements formed in the star into the surrounding space. These expelled elements become part of the raw material for new stars. Our Sun, for example, contains about 2% of these heavier elements, indicating it's a second or third generation star. It formed around 5 billion years ago from a cloud of gas enriched with debris from previous supernovas. While most of the gas in this cloud went into forming the Sun or was blown away, a small amount of the heavier elements came together to form the planets, including Earth. Initially, Earth was extremely hot and lacked an atmosphere. Over time, it cooled down, and gases released from rocks created the atmosphere we have today, which allowed for the development of life. This theory of the universe starting off very hot and cooling as it expanded is consistent with all the observational evidence that we have today. However, there is a problem. Scientists explain the universe using two fundamental theories, Einstein's general theory of relativity and quantum mechanics, developed by Max Planck, Niels Bohr, and others. The general theory of relativity, forming the foundation of the Big Bang theory, provides a detailed explanation of gravity and the large-scale structure of the universe. This theory applies to a vast range of distances, from just a few miles to the size of the observable universe. Quantum mechanics, on the other hand, deals with phenomena on extremely small scales, such as a millionth of an inch. Unfortunately, however, these two theories are known to be inconsistent with each other. They cannot both be correct. The concept of singularity, as we referenced earlier, is an example of this. In general relativity, a singularity refers to a point in space-time where gravitational forces cause matter to have an infinite density and zero volume, like at the Big Bang and in black holes. This is where the mathematical laws of physics, as described by general relativity, break down. However, in quantum mechanics, the concept of a singularity does not exist. Instead, it deals with probabilities and uncertainties at the smallest scales of atoms and subatomic particles. Physical quantities like position and momentum are not determined with infinite precision, but have inherent uncertainties associated with them, a concept known as the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. And so theories such as loop quantum gravity or string theory are created, which propose that at very small scales, space-time is composed of distinct, separate units rather than being a smooth, continuous fabric as discussed in general relativity. This would mean that there would be a smallest possible size or a minimum scale, which could prevent the infinite curvature and the formation of singularities, since space-time could not be compressed beyond this minimum scale. And so the search for a new theory that will combine both general relativity and quantum mechanics has been at the forefront of modern physics, a quantum theory of gravity. But if we zoom out and think about the evolution of the universe as a whole, we come to an interesting question. If the law of conservation of matter states that we cannot create or destroy matter, then how did all the matter around us come into existence? It is essentially another type of matter which contain its own antiparticles. Antiparticles have the same mass as their matter counterparts, but opposite electric charge. Not only that, but every particle has an associated antiparticle. This is well established and has been confirmed in experiments. And if matter and antimatter ever come into contact, they annihilate each other, producing energy. That is why technically the universe should only be filled with energy, not matter, but there was an asymmetry. The reason why is one of the biggest mysteries of particle physics. However, antimatter is extremely rare, but we know it exists. The first ever antimatter particle discovered is the positron, or the electron's counterpart, which is currently used in PET scans, hence the name positron emission tomography. But storing a positron would be extremely challenging because it will annihilate on contact with normal matter, releasing a large amount of energy. Therefore, it must be stored in a vacuum and suspended using electromagnetic fields. But even though antimatter and ordinary matter are intriguing and fundamental to our understanding of physics, they make up less than 5% of the universe's total mass and energy. The vast majority is something else entirely, a mysterious and elusive substance known as dark matter. Dark matter refers to a type of matter that, unlike the ordinary matter making up stars, planets, and everything we can touch, interacts almost exclusively through gravity. Remarkably, it doesn't seem to have significant interactions with the kinds of particles we're familiar with from the standard model of particle physics, like protons, neutrons, and electrons. But how do we know dark matter even exists if we can't see it? The evidence comes from various astronomical observations. For instance, galaxies spin faster than they would if only visible matter were present. Why? According to Newton's laws, the rotational velocity of these objects should decrease with distance from the center, much like how planets farther from the Sun orbit more slowly in our solar system. However, observations show that in galaxies, stars' rotational velocity remains constant or even increases with distance from the galactic center, which is counterintuitive. To explain these unexpectedly high rotational speeds, especially in the outer regions of galaxies, there must be additional mass exerting gravitational force that we cannot see. This is what we call dark matter. Similarly, the way galaxies move within clusters and patterns in the cosmic microwave background all point to dark matter's invisible yet influential presence. Even the very formation and scale of galaxies like our Milky Way hinge on dark matter's gravitational effects. But what exactly is dark matter? Is it a particle? If so, what properties does it have? How does it interact with itself and with the familiar particles of the standard model? These are questions that scientists are actively trying to answer. Various theories propose different candidates for the dark matter particles that make up 27% of the universe, but so far none have been directly detected. However, since dark matter works through gravity, the quantum theory of gravity that we referenced earlier would be able to solve these questions. While dark matter pulls through its gravity, another mysterious component, dark energy, seems to be pushing the universe apart. The discovery of the universe's accelerated expansion led to the hypothesis of dark energy, a mysterious force that permeates space. It's thought to make up about 68% of the universe, dominating its overall energy content. But the knowledge of its existence provides hope to many that one day we'll be able to teleport or even time travel. Some theories of this include the interior of rotating black holes and the realm of cosmic strings, which are hypothetical defects in space-time with immense tension, capable of creating conditions for rapid motion and time travel. However, the most popular one taken up today was written in a paper in 1935 by Einstein and Nathan Rosen, in which they show that general relativity allowed for what they called bridges, now known as wormholes. While they found these bridges wouldn't stay open long enough for travel since one would run into a singularity as the wormhole pinched off, later theories suggested advanced civilizations might be able to stabilize them. To maintain an open wormhole or to bend spacetime for time travel, a phenomenon known as negative energy density is needed. This concept, which emerges from the realm of quantum physics, suggests that certain conditions can lead to energy densities that are effectively less than zero. An energy density is energy in a given volume, so energy must be negative, since negative volume has no meaningful interpretation in classical physics to get a negative energy density. The Casimir effect, a well-documented and observable phenomenon in quantum physics, supports this idea. It demonstrates that virtual particles, particles that fleetingly appear and disappear in empty space, can generate regions of negative energy density under specific conditions. Supporting these theoretical concepts, we have tangible experimental evidence. For example, the way light bends during solar eclipses is a clear demonstration of the warping of spacetime, an effect predicted by Einstein's theory of general relativity. The Casimir effect further contributes to this understanding by showing that spacetime can exhibit properties like negative energy density that are essential for concepts such as wormholes and time travel. Looking at the vastness and complexity of the universe and of its components, from the smallest particle to the vast expanse of spacetime, it's hard not to be amazed about everything around us. And our growth as a species, from drawing on cave walls to the discovery of quantum mechanics, reflects an extraordinary journey of intellectual evolution, reminding us that the limits of our understanding of the universe are just horizons waiting to be expanded.